Marc Kölbrugge. That's a very difficult last name. You can forget it if you want. You can try to remember it if you like a challenge. I will test you afterwards if you can spell it. So I'm from the Netherlands and I'm the founder of Betalist. I'm curious, has anyone heard about Betalist before? Few people? Okay, cool. So for the people that don't know Betalist, it's quite simple actually. It's a website where every day we feature the latest five internet startups. So founders, makers of startups can submit their profile to us. We get about 1,000 submissions every month. And then we pick the most interesting ones, the most innovative ones every day, and we pick five to showcase to our audience of early adopters, journalists, investors, other entrepreneurs. And that's pretty much what Betalist is. More specifically, Betalist in numbers, it's almost 7 years old, which is quite old, I think, in the internet space. It didn't start out as a full-time company at first, but it is now. We do low six digits in revenue every year. We have received almost 50,000 startup submissions to date. So those are founders that fill out a form with their startup information. And we've chosen 8,000 startups to be featured. I think I should have checked, but I think yesterday or today or tomorrow we hit 8,000 exactly. And then I guess it's important to note that I'm guessing I'm like a digital nomad. I don't know if I like that word yet. It's a little bit trendy nowadays. But over the last year, over the last 12 months, I think I've been about 6 months out of the country and 6 months in the Netherlands. So I'm not like a full, what do you call it? Like full-time digital nomad where I'm like traveling all the time. Like I still have an apartment back in Eindhoven. But I actually just came back from a trip to Southeast Asia, like 2 weeks ago. Like I was in these places, like a few different countries. And it was a trip of about 4 months. And during those 4 months, I realized that I'm wasting a lot of money on like rent in the Netherlands. So I'm now gonna like give up my apartment in the Netherlands and become like homeless or like a full-time nomad or whatever you wanna call it. Yeah. So why am I here? That's also on the slides. But I also have to say it. So 3 weeks ago, Carlos sent me a DM on Twitter if I wanted to present at this meetup. So I asked like, okay, what do you want me to talk about? Like, well, he asked me like, can you talk about like how you manage a remote team and how you collaborate with your colleagues and your teammates? And I was like, oh yeah, sure, like sounds good. Like, and he said like, oh yeah, you can go to Gran Canaria, like we take care of everything. So that sounded really interesting. But then I realized that like, we're only two people, like Betalist is only two people. So I'm not doing much management. So what should I talk about then? And then I realized that I actually set up my company, I set up Betalist in a way where I don't need to do a lot of managing because I don't really like managing people. So that's brought me to the topic of today. And that's like, you just like you design your product, you can design your company. So you design your product for your customers, but you can design your company for yourself and maybe your colleagues in a way that you really enjoy working at your company. So why is that important? I mean, it's kind of like a stupid question. Like, why is it important to enjoy working at your company? But if you go back to one of my earlier slides, Betalist is almost 7 years old. And that's, I think, quite unique in the internet space because people are going from one idea to the other idea. And I used to be like that. I had like a few different companies before this, but they were nowhere near 7 years. They might have like lasted like a day or a few days. And maybe I'm like a little bit dramatic, but like I had like two real companies before that lasted like 2 or 3 years. But Betalist is almost 7 years and I'm still really enjoying it. So I think if you wanna be successful, you need to be patient, but you also need to create an environment for yourself where you can be patient and you don't mind working on the same thing for a long time. So you want to be aware of how you create an environment for yourself. And remote working and traveling is probably part of that for you guys, otherwise you probably wouldn't be here. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that as well today. So basically what I'm saying is, you can talk about tools or productivity hacks or discipline or like hustle. It's like very popular nowadays, like all the, like you have to hustle. And like startup methodologies and sweat equity, and like those are all important things. And I go too fast. Those are all important things. And we could talk about that, and I could talk about like all the tools I use. But ultimately, I think if you are in the wrong company, it doesn't matter how much tools you use or whether you use Trello or Pivotal Tracker or GitHub. Ultimately, it's all about like, do you enjoy working at your company, and does the company fit you? Like, people talk about product market fit. Do you have a product that the market wants? But there's also something like founder market fit. Do you work in a market where you as a founder like to work in? And then there's also founder product fit. Like, do you work on a product that fits you? So rather than focusing on this kind of stuff, I would say like build a company where you leverage your strengths, minimize your weaknesses, and and work the way that suits you. So the question is, do you work for the company, or does the company work for you? And one part of that is, do you have multiple shareholders, for example? Like, if you're going to raise funding, you have investors, so you kind of need to work for the company, because otherwise those investors are not going to invest in your company. So if you are like a solo founder or like a small team, you can have more flexibility on designing the company you want and have it work for you. And I'll talk more about that later. So today's goal, I'm going too quick again, is to like get started, get the discussion started about this way of thinking of actually designing your company or setting up your company in a way that actually suits you, that fits your strengths, minimizes your weaknesses, etc., and that works well for traveling. Like, maybe, I'm curious, how many of you currently have a company? How many are thinking of starting a company? Okay. So I think, whether you're like starting a company or already have a company, those are things you can work on. Like, if you're starting a company, you might probably still be thinking about what kind of product should I make, or what kind of customers should I help, what kind of market should I be in. So one other thing you want to think about is, what kind of day-to-day life do I want to live? Like, do I want to be working on emails? Do I want to be designing? Do I want to be on sales calls? If you're traveling, doing calls can be a little bit more tricky. Do you want to work with a team? Do you want to work by yourself, etc.? And if you're already running a business, like I am and like many of you are, you probably know that you are continuously like improving your workflows, not just your product, but the way you're working. I wonder how many people are like trying out new productivity apps like every few months or every few weeks. Maybe not as many, like maybe it's my problem that I have. But I always was thinking like, okay, if I just get the right productivity tool, then I will be productive. But the reality, of course, is that the productivity tool doesn't really matter that much. It's more about just working on the right things. So what I want to do today, that today's goal, is to get the discussion started, get you guys thinking about it. Maybe afterwards have a group discussion about it. And I will provide some different ways, some different tools, I guess, of thinking about this type of stuff. So the first question you want to ask is like, how would you like to work? So for many of you, or maybe all of you, that means like being able to travel. You want to leverage your strengths, of course, minimize your weakness, etc. This is kind of obvious stuff. So when you talk about your strengths, most people are kind of unaware of their strengths. Maybe I am as well. You might think you know like your strengths, but then if you ask other people like, what are my strengths, you might hear surprising answers. But so some ways of like really getting to know your strengths, like, and your strengths are obvious to you. Like, to me it's obvious that I can prototype something really quick, but then to someone else, like, they might not know how to program at all. So to me it's obvious that I can prototype, but someone else would say, oh, that's actually strength of you. And then the same for weaknesses, which I will go into detail later. But if you want to like get a better sense of what your strengths are, ask yourself like what topics are people asking you about, like what are they asking your help with? Which tasks do you enjoy working on? Doesn't necessarily mean you're good at it, but if you enjoy doing it, even if you're not good at it right now, you will probably become good at it at some point because you enjoy working on it, so you're gonna work a lot doing that. And what works well in your business. So there's probably things that are working well for you and things that might not work well for you. So for example, for me, what works well is like prototyping like a new idea. What doesn't work well is like communicating that to my colleague or like scheduling calls or that kind of stuff. So actually I list some of them here as well. Like my one of my strengths is that like I'm a one-man army, I call it. Like I can go from idea to prototype to actual working product that I can sell, to marketing it and to selling it and to like getting PR and that kind of stuff. So that sounds great as a strength, but it can also be a weakness because apparently I don't like to delegate, or I can't delegate. So I had to teach myself to do everything by myself. And there's only 24 hours in a day. So at some point, if I do want to scale up a little bit, then I have to start delegating a little bit. That's maybe one of my weaknesses. But the question is like, how do you leverage your strength? So in my case, one-man army, I build like a lot of products. I try a lot of things and a lot of them don't work, but that's okay. So some people that are maybe slower at building products, they might start by doing a little bit more research before they invest in like hiring a developer or a designer. For me, prototyping is my research. For me, it's quicker to actually build something really quick, ship it, see how the market responds, iterate, or decide not to continue or to decide to invest more time in it. So that's how I leverage the strength, one-man army. Move quick and break things. I'm not gonna spend too much time on my strengths because it's kind of stupid to be on stage doing that. So what are your strengths if you like traveling? This is probably true for many of you. Community building, I think it's actually, traveling is a great way to meet a lot of people. So like you can do marketing, you can do paid advertising, that kind of stuff. But by traveling, you actually meet a lot of people face to face, especially if you go to different kinds of meetups, etc. So I think that can be a strength. So if you're traveling, being able to meet a lot of people in different parts of the world can be a strength. Now, so you probably want to build a business that's, not probably, but you might want to build a business that's global and where you have customers in all these different places you visit, because then the traveling becomes a real strength of you, which your competitors might not have. Your competitors might be stuck at home or at an office, and so you have a benefit over them. Lower costs. If you travel and you decide to like cancel your apartment, and you move, you travel to like cheaper countries, then you have lower costs. If you still have your own apartment, or if you move to more expensive countries, then like it's gonna be more expensive. So then it's not a strength, but traveling can be a real benefit, a real strength. Get outside of the bubble. Maybe it's not much of a problem if you're from Europe or maybe Asia, but I think if you're like maybe from San Francisco, for example, or like New York, or like one of those really big startup hubs, then it's easy to like get into that bubble and not really realizing what the real world is like. And you might be making products, kind of what I'm doing, just for other startups. So like traveling gets you like a better perspective on the world, which can be a real benefit when you're building a business. So this is actually an example of like a few weeks ago in Kuala Lumpur while I was traveling, and I just sent out a tweet like, hey, I'm in Kuala Lumpur. Like I sent out a tweet from the Betalist Twitter account, like I'm the founder, I'm in Kuala Lumpur, does anyone want to meet up? And we were like a few people that, that wanted to meet up. So that for me, that was a great way as a human being to like get in touch with other human beings very easily. Like I was never in Kuala Lumpur before, but I made friends immediately because of my business. So your business can also help your personal life. And then this kind of meetup also helps my business because I get a better sense of the problems local communities have, like local startups have, that I might not otherwise know. So it can be a win-win on both sides. Then there's the weaknesses. So this is kind of obvious, like what types of tasks do you keep putting off? For me, it's like doing my taxes and that kind of stuff. Calls, anything where I need to type a lot, like emails. Maybe like fine-tuning my apps. I might like be able to go from idea to prototype and even like get it on the market real quick. But there's always like the fine-tuning I'm not really good at. So I should probably not compete with companies that are like really focused on detail and where it matters a lot. And then another thing I'm kind of bad at is because I'm traveling and I kind of work in sprints. So I might work like day and night for a few days and then I might like just relax for a few days. And there might be times where I'm unavailable to work while I'm traveling, while I'm at the airport or like taking a long flight. So that probably means I shouldn't build a product that's mission critical to my customers. Because then if my website goes down, for example, I need to be online to fix it. Or I need a bigger team, but we already discussed that's not something I want either. So one of my weaknesses is traveling in a way as well, that I'm not always available online. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later as well. And also look at your strengths. So your strengths are often weaknesses in disguise and vice versa. Like your weaknesses can be strengths in disguise. So again, my weaknesses are planning and I'm impatient. So I don't like thinking too much about the future. I just have an idea, I want to build it now. So the way I address that is by just not planning anymore and having a small team, like only one colleague, and she knows that I don't like planning. So sometimes she might ask like, what are you working on? Or like, what did you just ship this morning? Like, what did you ship over the weekend? And then I'll tell her, and then she'll kind of try to like deal with it with the customer support tickets we might get, because that's her responsibility. But so the way I deal with it is I found someone that understands me and that's willing to deal with that. And I have a very small team. Like if you have a larger team, you have to plan, right? You can't have everyone work on their own stuff without any planning or like strategy or that kind of stuff. So that's the way I mitigated that. And then impatient is just like, well, don't work with other people. Like just do it all yourself. You don't have to wait for other people. Except again for this one colleague, which probably covers most of my weaknesses, like communication. She takes care of pretty much other communication with customers, that kind of stuff. Then repetitive tasks, like customer support. I think it's important for every founder to be in direct contact with the customer, but there are some inquiries that might be repetitive and that might be difficult to fix in a product or otherwise, so you just keep having those questions. Or like sales can kind of become repetitive, still important, but still repetitive. So that's something I delegate. Even though, I like to have a small team, I chose to delegate that to my colleague. And then too excited about new ideas. I haven't really found a good solution for that. I'm working on new ideas all the time. And then because I'm the only one working on product, I'm spread too thin. Like we might have 10, 15 different products going on at the same time. And I can only work on one at a time. So I'm still figuring out like how can I like design my company in a way where that's actually beneficial, where this weakness becomes a strength. So I'm not sure exactly yet how to do that. But like I said, I'm able to quickly prototype, and it's a quick way to test out new ideas. So hopefully I can find a way to maybe prototype even quicker so I can actually try out all those ideas. Then what are the weaknesses of travel? Well, it doesn't have to be all virtual, but like if you're gonna do anything with like shipping stuff, like mailing stuff, or like if you're gonna start like a hardware company, Like, that's probably not something you want to do if you travel a lot, because I don't know if you want to like bring hardware with you, or if you're going to like start a VR company. Like the laptops currently, most laptops aren't fast enough at the moment. So I don't know if you want to bring like a big computer everywhere. So I think one of the weaknesses or like limitations of a remote company is that ideally it's all virtual. It's kind of difficult to collaborate, I find. It's much easier to like talk to people face to face, especially with a bigger team. You can use Skype and Slack and that kind of stuff, but in my experience, it doesn't work as well as like doing it face to face. So, and this might, what I say here is all my experience, so it might be different for you guys. But so if it's difficult to collaborate, maybe start a company that's less collaborative. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Scheduling calls can be difficult, especially if you're like traveling across different time zones. For me anyway, sometimes there are days that I'm just unable to work. Like a day that I'm flying, I usually have to get up early, then I have my flight at some point, and then when I arrive at my destination, I'm like too tired to work. And maybe then the next day, I'm like too excited to explore the city, so I might not work for a few days. Which is okay if you design a company around that. So something that works really well is if you have like a website, like a software as a service kind of thing, where people just sign up themselves and they pay you, and it's all automated. And then if they have a question, ideally your service is not mission critical, so it's okay if you answer it like a day or 2 days later, or you have someone else take care of that. Then another thing I would really look into is like, what's your preferred way of working? For me, it's kind of between working alone and with a team. Like, again, I like to like focus and get something done really quickly. And if I'm alone, I find that's quicker. But if I'm all by myself, I don't have anyone telling me like, or asking me like, hey, Mark, what are you doing? Like, why are you working on new thing when you started something new like 2 days ago? And so my colleague, she helps me with that. So having a team is nice, but I like to have a small team. Daily or sprints, like, do you like to have like a daily routine where like you work every day, maybe from 9 to 5, or like at least you work every day? Or do you like work in sprints like me, like you work like for a few days, maybe day and night almost, and then maybe a few days you don't work, and then another day you work like for an hour? Some businesses allow for that, some businesses don't. This is all kind of boring, I guess. So I think I already mentioned this. Yeah, so again, like, I like to ship now, fix later. And it doesn't work if you have like Fortune 500 companies as customers, probably. Or if you like create like medical hardware or software, like, or like something like with finances. Like, but what I make, if it's like, if the website is down for a day, hopefully it's not, but I can still get away with it. Okay, so now it's time for the beer countdown. So, like, this is the number of slides we have left, and we're gonna count down. Because I see I'm at 23 minutes, and I have like 20 to 30 minutes, right? So I think we're on schedule, but afterwards we have beers. So that's quicker. So let's see. Okay, so this is kind of boring. Now, so before we were looking at like your personal attributes, like what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses, what are your preferences. Another way of looking at it is like kind of more externally. So what kind of team size do you want? What kind of competitive landscape makes sense for your strengths and weaknesses, and if you're traveling, market size, etc. So these slides look really boring. But so for team size, you can start all the way on the left as a solo founder. Maybe you could even like go even further left if you automate everything. So there's like a team of zero. If you can do that, that would be perfect. But you probably start with at least yourself. All the way up until like multiple headquarters around the world. I think the sweet spot for remote workers, digital nomads, is somewhere around here. I don't know if you can read it. So it's solo. Maybe you work with some freelancers, or what I call like you work with a lunch group, which is basically a group that's like not that it's a group where you can have lunch with. So maybe like 10 people you can still have lunch with. If it becomes like 20 people, that's kind of like a different dynamic. And then one room group would be maybe like this. And then at some point you might have multiple departments. But so I think for digital nomads, you want to be around there, like from solo to maybe like a dozen people or so. Customer type. So all the way on the left, I have eyeballs. So that's basically if you're like selling advertisements, they call it like selling people's eyeballs. So that's like the smallest type of customer you can have, I guess. Then you have B2C, B2B, and enterprise. Again, I already mentioned a few examples when you don't want enterprise customers. B2C, it's kind of difficult because you need a lot of customers generally because they tend to pay lower amounts. And you need to start doing marketing and that kind of stuff. I think actually it might be possible for digital nomads, but it's if you're starting out at least, I would recommend starting with B2B. Because it's just you need fewer customers to be to get break even, and so that's where we are with Baitless as well. We're kind of like B2B, a little bit to the left. Maybe we have some startups that are not real businesses yet, and we're definitely not on enterprise because that's just too much stuff to deal with, like paperwork, sales calls, all the stuff I don't want. Responsibilities, I don't want responsibilities. So product complexity, it seems like everything is kind of on the left, what I would recommend. So on the all the way on the left, we have like consultancy or freelancing for specific clients, all the way to like doing hardware or like stuff that involves a lot of logistics. I would probably, what I prefer is like software as a service, or maybe content. Like if you're just starting out, you can like maybe write an ebook about something you're really good at, and you can have like a one-off thing you sell. What I don't personally like is content that's repetitive, or every day you have to publish content, which happens to be what we do at Betalist. So that wasn't a good design decision, but I was able to like kind of fix that by delegating that to my colleague. But if I would start a new business, I would start something where I don't have to do work every day. Like with Betalist, we have to feature 5 startups every day. And we can kind of like schedule it upfront. We could say like once a week, we schedule like 35 startups. But then our revenue model involves giving startups like priority on getting featured. So they pay us today to get featured tomorrow, which is like the worst revenue model I could come up with if I want to travel and like have days off, but that's kind of how it worked out, and I didn't really think about this kind of stuff when I started the company. But like I said, I was able to kind of fix that by hiring someone who is kind of available like every day. So we have like 2 beers left, we're making progress. So competitive landscape, that's a really boring word. It starts all the way on the left. Like maybe you're making custom solutions for someone. Again, I would say like consultancy. I mean, it can be competitive, but it's definitely not as competitive as like mass market, where what you build is something anyone in the world might want. So the nice thing about having a product over here is that it's a wide market, a lot of money to be made, but again, it's also a lot of competition. And if you're gonna have a small team, like I have, you don't have the resources to compete with people that are here. And all the way over to the left, I don't feel like I make enough money. So I'm kind of like focused on a niche, which is a profit there, or enough revenue to be made for it to be an interesting business. But it's not interesting enough to the big player, so you won't have as much competition. So I kind of ask myself, is this a market where I can be like in the top 3 or top 5? That's kind of what I enjoy being at. So if you're still starting out, go further to the left. If you're more experienced, you want to move to the right probably. But like a niche is probably the best way to go if you're starting out, or for pretty much everyone. So we have 2 beers left. So now we have 1 beer left. I don't know, maybe we're just going to skip this even. But yeah, those were kind of like the talking points I wanted to cover. So if any of you have any questions for me or any comments or notes for anyone else or questions to the group, I think now's the time.
How many products do you have now and how do you manage all of them?
I made a list for myself once, like a few weeks ago. I think there were like maybe 15 products on there I would consider like seriously like still active in a way, like active in either that I'm still seriously considering working on it or that they are already live. So yeah, around 15, and of which probably a beta list is definitely the biggest one, and then there might be around four that are like live and with users or like generating revenue or that kind of stuff, and then a whole list of like almost finished products and totally in progress. And then like there's a long list of unfinished and I'm not looking at it anymore. But that's not something I would recommend, by the way. Like if you can focus on one thing, I used to be like all over the place. And then I decided, okay, I'm gonna commit to one product for a longer time period. And that was beta list. And I committed to like only working on that for quite a long time. And then actually when I got my colleague on board, Rabia, she took over a lot of the stuff for me, and all of a sudden I had this free time and I was like, whoa, I can do all these new things I want to do. So then I went berserk and like started all these new products, and now I went back a little bit to focusing on beta list, and it's kind of like how do you say, like a wave of where I'm like focused on one thing and then I'm like, I'm bored with this, I'm gonna start something new. Yeah, over there.
Mark, I consider myself a part-time digital nomad from the Netherlands as well.
Yeah.
How do you manage your apartment back in the Netherlands? Do you rent it out?
Are you interested? Are you interested?
Sure.
So that's a great question. Like, it's a great question, but this is a very bad answer maybe, because I'm renting the apartments. By the contract, I'm not allowed to rent it out, and it's an apartment at Stripe S. It's like kind of like the community is small enough, and like the apartment building is small enough that they would notice it if I would Airbnb it, and like I would get kicked out right away. And this is also on video now, so I can't do it anymore. And I guess technically I could, or not technically, not legally, but I could like theoretically. Could rent it out, like sublet it, but then if I'm gonna sublet it, someone like for a longer time period, people probably want to have like some kind of security where they know like I'm gonna live here for at least 6 months. And then the question is for me, like, what's the benefit to me to sublet it? Because I'm probably not gonna make a profit on it because it's already a little bit expensive, maybe. So what I'm doing, what I've done in the last 4 months while I was traveling is like I wasted a lot of money. That's my method. And then my new method is to like cancel, like give up my apartment and travel freely without worrying about wasting all that money. So that's my plan now. And I'm really planning to like give up the apartment in like the next 2 months. And then when I'm back in the Netherlands, I'll just get an Airbnb myself. Or a hotel even. Like I made like a spreadsheet for myself. I can recommend anyone to do it. And in the spreadsheet, or at the end of the spreadsheet, I realized that it's cheaper for me to like travel maybe 6 or 8 months a year. And then when I'm in the Netherlands, just rent like Airbnb. Than it is to keep my apartment and also like pay for hotels, etc. While I'm traveling. So I think you can kind of make that calculation for yourself. And if you, I don't, if are you just starting out, like being like a digital nomad or like?
It's 1.5 years.
Okay.
And I spent 6 months here and spent some time in Southeast Asia as well. I still have my apartment back in Breda. So
okay. I studied there, yeah.
And I rent it out when I'm abroad.
This is being recorded, you know?
Yeah. My neighbors know about it.
Yeah. Now, if you're able to do that, I think I would probably prefer that myself as well. But I know with my current apartment, that's not really an option. And I'm not going to look for a new apartment right now just to rent it out. But when I come back to the Netherlands, I'll go back to the Netherlands in a few days, and then I will live in the Netherlands for a while, and then I go traveling. I will give up my apartment, then I will go traveling. And if I come back to the Netherlands then, I'll figure out what I want to do. I'll just try out the Airbnb thing, see if it's something I like. I can imagine that I would prefer a home base, but I'm just going to try it out. Something I realized that really helped is that nothing is permanent with this kind of stuff. Maybe selling a house or buying a house is, it's not even permanent, but it's semi-permanent. But just canceling my rent, I can always rent a new place. True. So I'm just gonna give it a try and see how I like it.
Okay.
Yeah?
So you mentioned defining your niche, and I'm kind of familiar with the beta list. So can you tell me how you determine your niche and I guess what it is?
So when I first started beta list, I didn't consider it a company I was starting. The reason I started beta list was to promote one of my own startups. It was just a quick way to get some publicity. And then it turned out that beta list was actually doing better than the original startup I was trying to promote. So I didn't really think of I need to have a niche, but I did see an unfulfilled need in the market. And that was, on the one hand, startups that were still in the beta stage found it difficult to get publicity, to get on TechCrunch, for example, because TechCrunch tends to feature startups that are launched, or maybe in some exceptions, if you're Kevin Rose or famous founder, or you have you raise a lot of funding, then you might get PR coverage before you launch. But generally, you only get PR coverage when you launch, and you get it once. And that was a problem for startups that needed beta testers to get feedback before they launch, because you want to launch a great product with as few bugs as possible. So I thought that was a need, for early stage startups to get publicity, which is kind of niche. And then on the other hand, I thought that there's a lot of early adopters, people that try out new apps, new betas, like me, and they weren't really being served either. You can visit TechCrunch to discover new startups, but there wasn't a place to discover just the pre-launch early stage startups back then. So that's why I created that. I figured both markets were not being served, and I figured why not me? Any other questions or
what
comments?
What tools do you use the most when you work remote?
Coffee, chairs, desks. Tools. I think a lot of tools anyone would use just for whether you're remote or not, Sketch and Vim as a code editor and that kind of stuff. But specifically for working remotely, maybe this is kind of obvious, but I use Twitter to find people to meet with, to keep in touch with my colleague. We used to do a weekly Skype call to keep in touch and to discuss pressing issues. And then when I started traveling a little bit more, I suggested I don't know if I will be available for a Skype call on the regular time. So can we just plan a call when it makes sense for both of us? And then we never actually planned a call for 4 months. But we did chat through Slack and later Telegram, and that worked actually quite well. Whenever we do a Skype call, we fill all the time we plan. But by not doing any Skype call, we didn't really miss anything. We missed being in touch. So when I was back in the Netherlands, we met up again. But asynchronous communication through Slack or texting worked quite well, actually, we found out. And then something I already told you, but something my colleague found out is that I'm difficult to reach on Slack. because I actually have to open the app to see the messages, because I turn off push notifications, because there's so much going on there with all the automated stuff. So at some point, she started reaching out to me on Telegram, like, hey, Mark, like, you really need to look at this. And that actually works better, because I'm in Telegram all day, like, talking to friends and stuff. And Telegram feels more lightweight. I don't know if it makes sense, like, rationally, but Slack feels like this big thing I need to open, and, like, there's a lot of stuff going on, and Telegram is more lightweight. And it doesn't feel right, because, hey, we have Slack, why are we using Telegram? But it works. So I would say just use the tools that work, and if something's not working, try something else. Kind of obvious. Any other questions or comments, or maybe like you're like, oh, I don't agree with you at all?
I'm just curious, because being a European founder yourself, do you have like a focus on European startups, or do you tend to feature European startups, or did you start out by featuring like Dutch startups, or was there any time and geographical?
No. Like, I started out by like just finding some startups on Hacker News. Technology, I don't know how I would describe it, but like there's startups on there. I found a few. Then I got featured on TechCrunch with BetaList. And then actually startups just started to come to us. So like I said, we get like, I think over 1,000 submissions every month now. And we just pick the ones we like the best. And we don't look at where they're from. And a lot of them obviously are from Silicon Valley, the US in general, but we also have a lot of startups from India actually. But we haven't made like a conscious decision to only focus on specific startups, like specific countries, because yeah, for us, there was no reason to do that. I think if someone would start like a BetaList competitor right now, I would recommend to start with like a country that's underserved by BetaList maybe. And I noticed like countries where not everyone speaks English. Like there's some, I know like in China, I think someone started like a BetaList competitor in China, like BetaList.cn. They actually copied the name and everything. I don't think they exist anymore. I think we'd send like a cease and desist or something. But so that actually, like just because they use the same name, like I don't mind people doing the same thing. Like, but I think like, we don't reach the Chinese market, for example, that well, because Chinese people tend to prefer reading in Chinese and not in English. So so if someone would want to start a competitor, then it makes sense focusing maybe just on China or just on another country. But no, we didn't focus on one particular country.
Why not localize it?
Too much hassle, I think, anyway. So I don't know if it's worth the trade-off. So let's say we could, I'm just making up numbers, but let's say we could increase traffic by 20% by doing that. I don't know if that's reasonable. I think there's a lot of other things we can do to raise traffic by 20% that's not structural. Like localizing is structural. Like I need to learn Chinese. My colleague needs to learn Chinese, for example, or maybe more obvious, like you hire like a translator, but then like you expand the team and you have one more thing that can go wrong. Like everything you automate, it's less likely to go wrong in my experience. But like by adding, I was actually calculating this, like if it's just you, it's just you, you don't have to worry about much. If you add like one person, it's just you and that person and you can communicate. But the moment you add like a third person, it becomes like exponentially more complex, because you have to communicate with that person and the other two people have to communicate with each other as well. And you as the founder have to be aware of the relationship between those people. So now let's add like another translator, you know? So like it becomes more and more complicated. But maybe if I can find someone that knows like a lot of languages and I have like one translator that can do everything. Or maybe there's like a service, like an API, like I just sent a text and they send the translation back to me. Maybe it's worth it, but then still you need to do the marketing for those different cultures as well. So it's not as easy as just like translating the text.
But the content is also different, it's a different market. So then only translating the interface
Yeah, so you have to translate the interface and the content, and then you also have to make the decision whether, like, for example, Middle East China, would those just be Chinese startups, mm-hmm. or would they still be like all the startups, yeah. but just translated to Chinese? Because we have some Chinese startups, but the text is in English. I don't know, like, what Chinese people would be interested in. Like, would they only be interested in like Chinese startups, or like every startup? Do they want to see like what's happening in the rest of the world? But maybe at some point we'll do that, but it's not really a priority right now. We're working on some other things that have like a better ROI for us. There was a question here earlier.
Yeah, I don't know if it hasn't been asked before, but what other productivity tools would you recommend on the
Slack? One thing I use all the time, and I keep forgetting that I use it because I use it so much, is called Text Expander. And it's basically, it's built in into macOS right now as well, like a simpler version, but basically it allows you to type like a snippet of text. For example, I might, like, I have a long name, I don't want to type my name all over like every time I need to fill out a form. So I type, I think, MMK for Marc Kölbrugge, and it, like, it expands to like my full name. Or I might type like my address. Or like with customer support, it's nice if I can just type a few letters and like this is long, like, oh, thank you for your email, blah, blah, blah. Or like URLs, like betalist.com/advertise, I use a lot. So I just type BLAD, I think. So that's called Text Expander. And it actually saves a lot. It might sound like a simple thing, but it actually saves like a ton of time. I also have like a snippet where I can copy something to my pasteboard, and if I then type /URL, it finds the first Google result for that word I copied to my pasteboard and gets a URL for that. So if I would like type digital nomads Gran Canaria meetup, that's actually a lot of typing, but like if I would type I don't know, maybe I would type that, or I would type Gran Canaria weather. I just select it and then I type /URL and it will get the first URL from google.com. And oftentimes you already know you want the first URL if you're sending it to someone through like a texting app. So I use that a lot. I use something called Alfred, which is kind of like Spotlight on the Mac, but it has more functionality to search. So it's something I do, maybe I don't know if you can show it here. Let's see. So this is Alfred. You can just search for. You need to type correctly. For like programs, but something I use all the time is I build my own like little snippets or searches, so I can type for. For example, like a Twitter username, and then if I hit enter. Well, you actually go to the, it's on the wrong screen. You go to the admin area of BetaList and you see the profile of that specific user. And I have the same for user ID. So if I see like a user ID somewhere, I need to go to the profile. I type like BLUD or something like that. And then the ID number, and then I go to the user profile, and the same for all the startups we feature. So what I did before, I went to this URL and then I pasted in like a email address or like a number, and then I hit enter, and now I do it all in one go pretty much. So those are kind of like tools that help your productivity a lot, I think. And then let's see, what else do I use? I don't know how interesting this is. Like, I have like Backblaze to do my backups, like online backups. Especially if you travel a lot and you don't have like external hard disk, you want to back up to the clouds. Backblaze works really well for that. Nothing really. Oh yeah, something I just started using is called Notion. It's like a wiki. Do you guys remember wikis? Oh yeah, you still have Wikipedia, right? I don't know if I can show this. Maybe actually I can show you like my list of projects I have going on. This is really difficult to type like this. I can show you later on my phone. No. Yeah, I don't. So I try not to focus too much on the productivity tools, like I said earlier. It's kind of like a rabbit hole. You can lose yourself, like going from the one to-do app and like migrating other to-dos to the other to-do app. But really, what you want to do is you want to work on your product, and not so much on all the stuff around it. I think. Yeah, over there.
So when you first started BetaList in the beginning, how did you kind of get your first users? And how did you?
So I was very fortunate in that I got featured on TechCrunch, one of the largest technology blogs, like 2 days after I had the idea for BetaList. And I actually wrote about it. Like, there's an article called How I Tricked TechCrunch into Writing About My Startup. And that's like the whole story of how BetaList started. But like, yeah, what's important for your question is that I got featured on TechCrunch really early, and I think one of the ways you can get featured on a website like that is really understanding what the job is of the journalist. Like, a lot of startups, they think like, I want to get featured, here's my awesome idea, do I get featured? Well, no, probably not, because there's a lot of startups and everyone wants to get featured. So you really want to understand like, what's the job of the journalist or the blogger? Well, their job is pretty much to write articles to get page views. And which kind of articles get page views? Well, you just look at the previous articles and you see, you look at the ones which got shared the most. And those are usually not just descriptions of startups, even though that's what we're doing at BetaList, but they're usually like telling a story. So when I tell someone like, okay, BetaList does this and that, I don't know how interesting that is, but if I tell people like, this is the story of how I tricked TechCrunch into writing about my startup, like all of a sudden everyone pays attention. So you want to have like a story around your startup that the journalist can share with their audience. And you kind of want to make the journalist think that they come up with the angle of the story. Like, if you just pitch them like a full story, they're like, oh, we can't publish that. But if you like drop in like a few hints and then they're like, well, actually it would make for an interesting story for our audience, then you're more likely to get featured. But so yeah, that's how we got our first users through TechCrunch. And then one of the really nice things about the way BetaList is set up is that the startups, once they get featured, they're really happy and excited and proud, and they're gonna share it with their networks, or they're gonna like spam their Facebook and Twitter like, look, we got featured on BetaList, which is a lot of free publicity for us. And then the early adopters, like the people checking out the startups, they kind of want to show off like, hey, look at which startup I discovered. Like, I'm one of the first ones to discover this startup. So we kind of have that virality built in, I guess. And then one thing we also do is when a startup is featured, a few days later, we ask them like, hey, how did it go? And would you be interested in like writing like a Medium post about it, or like a blog post about your experience? Because we know from our experience that those get shared a lot, so you might get some additional publicity by doing that, and we get some publicity as well. And we often share those case studies. So maybe someone gets like 500 signups and they write about it, then we might actually give feedback on the article. We might say like, oh, if you include like a few graphs on your Google Analytics, you tend to get like more shares on Twitter. And so then they write the article and then we share it and like everyone wins, you know? Like, it's like free content for entrepreneurs. The startup gets more publicity and we get more publicity as well. So yeah, that's kind of how we got our first users, and that's still how we get our users. Any other questions or comments?
I got one slightly philosophical question.
Sure.
Presentation is great, and I enjoy like the thinking about how to start the company. I was thinking of it like, when you design your company, it seems very much to that you design the company to facilitate the lifestyle.
Yeah.
And I wonder, like, when you these other projects that you have, is it always like you start with, oh, I wonder if I could like make revenue doing this, or is it more like you think that, oh, this is kind of the problem I'm going to solve?
Right. That's a good question.
Something as kind of the contender.
So for me, like money doesn't make you happy, which sure helps. No, but like I like the challenge. Like it's easy to just build random stuff, and maybe no one uses it. Like I don't. I mean, that's for me. That, I mean, once you know how to program, it becomes like easy. Like if you're just starting out, that by itself is like rewarding. But once you know how to build products, it's not rewarding anymore unless people use it. And at some point, it's not rewarding anymore unless people value it so much that they're willing to pay for it. So for me, I do ask myself very early on, is this something I can generate revenue with at some point? Partly because I like the revenue, I like the money, but I also it's also a way of asking myself, is this actually providing value? It's a different way of asking it. And not everything that provides value generates revenue necessarily. But yeah, that's kind of how I look at it. And I think if you want to build something that exists for a longer time period, like it has to be self-sufficient in some way. And usually that means, or it could mean like if it generates a little bit of revenue, it's worth investing a little bit more time in it. And in my experience, projects I have that didn't generate revenue, like for me, I can keep investing in it, but then it's just a hobby and that's fine. But ideally it's more than a hobby. Like Betalist still feels like a hobby, but I can't go full time on it because it generates revenue.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. And I like seeing like revenue numbers go up. I mean, who doesn't? But like for me, that's like again, not necessarily for the money, but like for the challenge. Does it answer your question?
Yeah,
yeah. Any other questions? Or like I'm still kind of hoping maybe for someone saying like, oh, it's not true. Maybe afterwards, after a few beers, like we are.
Well, the not true thing. So, yeah.
You still have one beer.
So, a few slides back, you had a comparison of like complexity in the product. Mm-hmm. And you had app and platform. So, sorry, app and SaaS.
Yeah.
I was wondering why those two are like. You think that SaaS is less complex than app?
So take this with a grain of salt. Like I made this up. This is.
Yeah.
Just one person that like N is one, if you're like a data scientist. In my experience, if you're building a mobile app, it's like the technology is a little bit more advanced or like a little bit more complicated than web technologies. That's my experience anyway. I haven't, like last time I tried building an app was like, I don't know, like maybe 6 years ago. But like with an app, you have to deal with either like Apple or like the Google Play Store, or maybe both if you want to like target everyone, which maybe you want to, and then like you have multiple platforms to keep in mind. You might have multiple screen sizes to accommodate for. Maybe for someone else, those could be switched. Like if you are like Swift developer or Objective-C, then this would probably be more to the left for you. It would be less complicated. But generally, if I look like the average person, I would say like building like software as a service tends to be a little bit easier. Also because if you look at pricing, it's very difficult to get people to pay like a monthly fee for like an app. And most apps are kind of like $3 or $4 or free. Or advertising based. So you need like a lot of customers. It's generally more B2C than B2B, which we already kind of discussed. It's kind of difficult to make work. And with software as a service, it's usually more B2B. And with software as a service, you can actually start out easier as well. Like when you first start building your product, you don't necessarily need to have like a sign-up flow or even like payment processing built in, because you can, for the first few customers, like for the first 5, 10, 20 customers, you can just do it by hand. I'm actually working on a new product right now, of course, where like I think I have about 5 customers right now, And those, every customer, it should be software as a service, but every customer has their own version of the code base running, and I just duplicate the code base, like control C, command C, control V, kind of. And then I change like a few, like the naming and the branding and stuff. And that's how I'm starting out. And that's not efficient at all, but it's a very quick way to go from zero customers to five customers without building all the onboarding and payment stuff. And now I kind of know, like, okay, there's a market for it, so it makes sense to invest in like automating that a little bit more. And I think in my experience, it's easier to do that approach with like software as a service than it is with apps. Like with an app, you can't really fake it. Like I'm faking like the sign-up flow kind of right now. With an app, it's a little bit more difficult. But if you're an app developer or just build an app,
I do agree that the prototyping is a lot easier.
Yeah.
But in the end, product complexity is something different than prototyping.
Yeah, that's true. Although, like, hopefully you keep iterating on your app or on your websites. Mm-hmm. But yeah, maybe for you those would be changed around. Like, I wouldn't tell anyone here like definitely don't build an app or definitely like take this as like the holy grail of like. Yeah. Any other questions, or are we looking at the?
Okay, we got three.
No more questions for now. If you have any questions or comments afterwards during the beers, then I will be running away. No, I'm happy to talk. So then we have one slide left. Yeah, beer. Thank you.